You're listening to 91 Reasons, a journey into the twisted landscape of pop culture. Keep your hands and arms inside the podcast at all times. And now, the voice, Jeff Tucker.
When you're young and you have a family that goes to church, which I did, you go to church. Like, we went to church more than most people did because my mother was very involved in the church. She was church treasurer. I think I've said that before on the show. She was also in the choir. So church was not just a Sunday morning affair. Church was a Sunday morning affair, Thursday night affair, and sometimes Monday or Tuesday, like a lot of people from the South, church is a the center of your social stratosphere in your life. You fraternize with the people from church. You go to their bedside when they're sick. You help them when they're hungry. You socialize when everybody's doing fine. And my mother, having grown up the granddaughter of a traveling Methodist minister, she was brought up Methodist, so we were brought up Methodist too. And the thing about going to church every week and learning the rituals of whatever religion you happen to be, those rituals become important. And more than important for children, they become fact. And the gospels that I was taught in the Methodist church were presented as fact. Jesus was a real person. God is a real person. The Holy Trinity is a real and tangible thing. And that forgiving yourself and asking God to forgive your sins will allow you entrance to heaven. And heaven is a real place. And it's not until later in life that you get to make that choice. Do you believe? What is your faith? What do you believe? But when you're taken as a child, it's just presented as fact. And there's my phone going off, even though I thought I turned it off. So I will turn that off. Sorry about that. But when you're presented it as fact, it changes the way you look at things. If you've got kids that are listening, we're going to get into some strange stuff because of the subject matter. You know, Santa Claus, the Easter Bunny, the Tooth Fairy are presented as fact, the same way that Jesus is. And if you choose to believe when you get older, then Jesus and God remain fact for you. I've never had a problem with that. Everybody's allowed to believe and have whatever faith they want. And that's what makes me a tolerant person. I don't force my religion on anybody, nor do I expect anyone to force theirs on me. And isn't that how every great war starts, right? So it was interesting to watch a guy who made a film about slackers working at a convenience store, slackers hanging out at the mall, and then guys who had a job, a very good job, and a successful business going, watching one of them throw it all away because he was in love with a lesbian. And it was strange to watch a guy who made those three movies, Kevin Smith, tackle such a strange movie like Dogma. And Dogma is a very strange movie. I remember, like most of the early Kevin Smith movies, probably up until, like, where did it lose its luster for me? Cop Out? Not his fault, I get it. Jersey Girl, not a fan of that film. Loved Clerks 2. But that's because I love Dante and Randall. And it was a bummer to me that all the films between Clerks and Clerks 2 while they may have featured Brian O'Halloran and Jeff Anderson, they didn't feature Randall and Dante. But that's not to say there wasn't a lot of anticipation for Dogma to come to theaters, and even more so when it was announced that Miramax, that had the rights to distribute the film, they weren't going to, because Disney had bought Miramax and decided that they weren't going to release a movie like that. And there was some confusion over how they could release a movie like Priest, which is about a Catholic priest having an affair and breaking all of his vows, and what seemed to be a light and fluffy comedy from the director of Mallrats, Dogma. Well, nobody puts millions of dollars into a movie not to have it actually hit the theaters at some point. Very rarely does a film get completely shelved. There have been instances of it. The Roger Corman Fantastic Four film was shelved, but it was never really meant to be released. The Jerry Lewis The Day the Clown Cried was never going to be released and never will be released. But still, like, there are other movies. The James L. Brooks movie, I'll Do Anything, was released, but originally it was a musical, and all the music was stripped out of it, but written by Prince, no less, and the movie was released as a straight drama and bombed and was never heard from again. You probably never even heard of it, but it was a musical with all the music by Prince. And it vanished. There was also a movie version of the musical, the very popular and long-running musical, The Fantastics. I don't think that movie ever saw the light of day. But with a fan base like Kevin Smith and a pretty gruff and forceful producer like Harvey Weinstein, Dogma was going to make it to theaters. So it did arrive in theaters courtesy of Lionsgate, who had the guts to release it. But it wasn't without its controversy even after that. There were picketing, people picketing the movie. They hadn't even seen it. At one point, Kevin Smith went down and joined the picket parade with a sign of his own, even gave an interview. That's pretty funny. And Dogma is a movie that is made very well as far as Smith's prowess as director. It's growing. There are still some pretty bad, badly directed scenes in the film. But overall, Dogma arrived in theaters as a pretty well thought out, fleshed out take on mainstream religion. And I think that looking back on it, and it seems quaint to look back on it, here we are in 2015, 16 years later. And boy, when you look at 1999, what a lot of movies came out that lasted. Like if I said, name five movies from 1998, you might have trouble. But if I said the same thing about 1999, it would be pretty easy. Matrix, Phantom Menace, Spy Who Shagged Me, Dogma, Notting Hill. I mean, a lot of movies have withstood the test of time from 99. But overall, Dogma just comes off really mean-spirited. And I think that's a fair assessment, because I think it's supposed to be mean-spirited. But it really is that, like, it's weird because it opens with a disclaimer, or something telling you what a disclaimer is, covering one's own butt, and then a disclaimer, and then another disclaimer saying, don't be offended, don't be offended, don't be offended. And then it just does everything in its power to offend you, the moviegoer. Even if you're casually religious, Dogma is going to offend you. Kevin Smith stacks the deck so high against religion, which is odd because he said he's a Catholic, raised Catholic. His daughter was raised Catholic. I went to Catholic church a few times. I couldn't figure out why they were always either standing up or sitting down. And no kidding, the little booth off to the side, one by one, the family I was with went into the little booth. And when it came like to my turn, I said, well, I'll be next. And they said, really? I said, yeah, I really got to go. They said, that's not the bathroom, Jeffrey. It's the confessional. I didn't know what that meant as a kid. I do now. And it's weird to think like Kevin Smith took this huge missile aimed at the Catholic Church and basically just utterly destroys them. And this is before the Catholic priest scandal. Imagine if Dogma had been made a few years later. What kind of storyline it would have had in regards to the church allowing priests to molest young children and then moving them around from parish to parish to avoid prosecution. Smith would have had a field day with that. And I'm not going to sit here and defend the Catholic Church in any way, shape, or form. That's not my job. My job is to review the movie. And what I get of the movie is that Smith's got some major problems with Catholicism, and it's right there on the screen. The minute the movie opens and George Carlin is presented as a cardinal, Cardinal Glick, George freaking Carlin. George Carlin might be the funniest comedian that has ever lived. Before I watched Dogma, I actually got into a little bit of a Carlin mood, and I went to listen to some of his classic stand-up bits. Carlin was one of the most informative, informed, intelligent, and versatile comics. He took down major establishments. He mocked the establishment. He was, along with Lenny Bruce, the people who broke the barriers and allowed comics like Sam Kinison and Andrew Dice Clay and Chris Rock and Dennis Leary to emerge and say what they wanted to say. You know, you'd have to put Richard Pryor in there too. And Eddie Murphy to some degree. Eddie Murphy was a little later. But if there are those of you in the audience who have never seen a George Carlin concert, man, am I jealous. And two, go right now to YouTube and look up some of the man's stuff. You'll be astounded at how smart he is. Now, this was a guy who didn't care about anything. He destroyed everything in the funniest way possible. So having him represent the church is, need we say more? Need we say more, right? So Carlin's there as Cardinal Glick to let you, the audience, know that the Catholic Church has decided that they're far too stuffy, that they're losing parishioners, and they're going to change their image by adding the Catholicism Wow campaign. And it's going to start with redefining our image of Christ. And no longer are we going to look at the crucified Christ and him dying for our sins, but instead he unveils the buddy Christ, which is Christ giving you the thumbs up and winking at you. So right in the first few moments, we're taking huge pot shots at basic Christian Catholic dogma. The fact that the church is stuffy. It's supposed to be. The fact that Christ on the cross is hard to look at. Well, you know what? It's supposed to be. So right away, we see the tone of the movie. And that's followed up by, that is the follow-up to a very strange scene of Bud Cort from Harold and Maude staring at the ocean and being attacked by children and then ending up in a coma. And it's not fully explained at this point who that guy is, but he'll come into play later. So then we're introduced to our main character. Her name is Bethany, and she's played by Linda Fiorentino, who was in Men in Black and the very, very good movie, The Last Seduction. But here, she's completely miscast in the movie because you can tell, I don't know how she ended up in this production, but she does not like the material. She looks half asleep in every scene. And her dialogue, which is not her fault, but it consists mainly of, who are you and what are we doing here? If you watch this movie, notice how many times, take a drink every time Bethany asks, Who are you and what are we doing here? And you'll be drunk by reel two. And I really hate that because the main character should ask questions at the beginning and then form a plan and then do whatever is being asked of them. If they're constantly questioning all of the other characters, who are you? What are you doing in the story? Well, funny you ask. It gets really tedious. And the main issue I have with Dogma is that so many of the scenes are boring, even though the dialogue and the information that we're being given is fascinating, and it is a very scathing, smart elicky take on not just Catholicism, but all Christian religions. The problem is that it literally is people sitting around talking. Which, in Jaws, when they talk about the Indianapolis, is a welcome break from the chase. We're going to break and we're going to learn to get to know these guys and learn who they are, what makes them tick, and then we're going to be rested for our finale. The problem is that Dogma is littered with these scenes. Oh my God, so many scenes of exposition and explanation and very little of it organic. And that's a problem. So the movie is about two angels, Bartleby and Loki, played by Ben Affleck and Matt Damon, and they've been stranded on Earth for a millennia because Loki, the flaming sword of God who would smite the humans in the Old Testament, decided one day that with Bartleby's urging to lay down his sword and not do that anymore. Well, what they got was expulsion from paradise. They were thrown out of heaven, stranded on Earth. So they've just been bumming around Wisconsin, of all places, which is interesting because what did they do up until what? 300? No, less. 200 years ago? When nothing was going on in Wisconsin, 150 years ago, did they just stare around at each other all day? I don't know. It's not explained. But they get a letter, and we don't see who it's from, but they get a letter, and it interrupts Loki convincing a nun that she's ruined her life and it's not too late to start over, which is another, like, zing, zing, right at Catholicism. Here's a nun who's devoted her life to God, and he talks her out of it in like 2 minutes. But Bartleby and Loki get a letter saying that part of the Catholicism Wow campaign is that the Catholic Church in Red Bank has an arch that's a little known part of the Catholic faith that says that if you walk through the arch, all your sins are forgiven. You get to go to heaven. So they're going to walk through the arch and get back into heaven because they're going to walk through the arch, make themselves immortal, and get the police to kill them. Now, it's not explained how they're going to do all this, but it's all in there. So their plan is they're going to get back in heaven, and that sets the whole movie in motion. And it's basically a road picture, because Bartleby and Loki have to get from Wisconsin to New Jersey, and Bethany has to get from Illinois to New Jersey to stop them, and that's the movie. Now, Bethany, again, here we are. We're going to get hit over the head again by Kevin Smith's anti-religion tirade via this movie. And of course, Bethany she works at Planned Parenthood, which is in the news this week, right? She performs abortions. Let that sink in. It's not shown, thank goodness. But our main character does abortions. She's also unable to have children of her own. And that's why her husband left her. And that's why she's a wreck. So she's seeking redemption in life. And it comes in the form of the very talented Alan Rickman as Metatron, the voice of God. And he shows up to give her a quest to go to New Jersey and stop the angels. Which she doesn't want to do. She doesn't want to go. And I really like the scene with Rickman. Like, I like any scene with Alan Rickman. Because Alan Rickman is an unbelievably talented actor. I don't get the angels' constant needs to prove that they're angels, to prove that they're not human, they show you their genitals because they have none. So there's an extended weird shot of Alan Rickman standing there with his pants down, showing you that he's a Ken doll. And maybe I don't think I ever found this funny. It just comes off like it's so obviously plastic, some sort of thing that he's encased in. It doesn't look right. It doesn't look like it's a live part of him. And there must be a different way. He ends up showing her his wings. Wouldn't that be a more dignified thing for the angel to do to prove who he is? He transports her via teleportation to a Mexican restaurant. So they have tricks up their sleeve. But again, you know, you have to buy in to the Kevin Smith view askewniverse where everybody uses the F word, no matter who they are. Everybody speaks smart alecky. And you know what? I'm willing to buy all that because I'm a Kevin Smith fan. I like this guy's movies. But wouldn't it have been a more interesting choice if Rickman didn't say the F word all the time and wasn't so angry about things and instead was like, I'm here to give you a quest. It's a real thing. Now, Rickman sells the dialogue like nobody's business. Again, it's Rickman. But it's just a little weird, like he's got to pull his pants down and he's got to curse. And, you know, better choices on the written page could have been made. Now, here's where the bad, and you know, I want to say bad directing, but it's actually more correct is bad editing. Take the scene where Bethany ends up back in bed after the Mexican restaurant, reaches under a pillow, and pulls out the maracas that he had, that Metatron had in the restaurant. So, proving to you, the audience, it wasn't a dream. She really did have tequila with an angel. But see, we have to move the story forward. So she walks out of her house to go to work, and the next shot is her leaving work at night. Just go ahead and watch it. It's very abrupt. It's, I don't know if you needed a scene of her at work or if you needed some sort of way to let us, the audience, know there had been a passage of time. So it's a little weird. It's a little choppy. But I've come to expect in a lot of big budget movies, and Dogma was, you know, relatively mildly budgeted, that sometimes, no matter the best laid plans of mice and men, you get into that editing bay and you simply don't have it. And you don't know what you're going to do, so you just cut it together and you go, look, let's watch it 10 times. You got it. You're okay. She's done with work. And that's fine. There's a nice cameo by Janine Garofalo as her friend at work. Of course, she's the Jewish girl who works at the abortion clinic. So there's something to say about that. Got to work in some of the other religions, right? Rickman tells Bethany that she's going to be aided in her quest, which she has not decided to go on, by two prophets. And they show up in the form now. She's attacked by the same group of hockey-wielding kids that attacked the old man in New Jersey. Again, these are three characters that I just don't care about. They're called the Stygian triplets or something, but they're just, like, you watch it and you go, well, it's a Kevin Smith movie. So, of course, there's guys in it playing hockey. So, okay, I'm rolling my eyes. You can't see it. There might have been a better choice there. I don't know what it is. It's not my movie to make. And I know you have to review the movie you got, not the movie that you wanted. So I get that. The triplet thing, it just doesn't work for me. I just don't quite get it. But Jay and Silent Bob show up, and they decide to hit the abortion clinic because that's where they say loose women hang out. They fight off the twins, and we get a moment of, now you have to explain this, what are Jay and Silent Bob doing in Illinois? And the answer is that is Kevin Smith wrote a comic book series called Chasing Dogma, which takes place from the end of Chasing Amy to the beginning of Dogma and explains how Jay and Bob got from Red Bank to Illinois, and they're on their way back to Red Bank. So it does make sense. Now, most of that comic series ended up as Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. Wonky, weird, but it's in there. But they do have a pit stop in Illinois at the high school that just happens to have all of the John Hughes characters in it. So it is worth picking up if you're a Kevin Smith fan, just to see, like, he's thinking of bridging these things through other medium. And this is pretty amazing for 98 and 99 when, you know, most studios weren't considering that at all. Canon didn't bother them in the least, you know, but at least for the Viewers universe, he's thinking about it. So here's another abrupt scene. Bethany, Jay, and Bob, first they go to a diner and have more dialogue and more dialogue. Again, it's Kevin Smith, so it's good dialogue. But eating English muffin and jam, it isn't considered action or something dynamic going on while they're talking. And again, if this is a movie where there's one scene of characters sitting around a table talking, then it's okay, because that's the talking scene. But Dogma has so many of them that the movie is 80%, you watch it, 80% sitting around talking. They talk at the diner. They talk on the train. They talk in the bar. They talk in the toy store. They talk at the strip club. Like, that's the movie. I get that's the movie. We're gonna get the characters from A to B. We're going to tackle religion and rip it apart. Then we're gonna go to another location and do the same thing. And that's the, if you can't buy that, this is not the movie for you, because that is the movie. So watch this editing scene where Jay's driving. He won't move it out of first gear, so he burns the engine up. She gets mad. They cut to Jason Lee enters the movie as Azrael, the demon from hell who is behind the whole thing. He sent the letter. He set them in motion. Now, the reason Bartleby and Loki cannot pass through the arch is that they were damned by God himself, or in the case of Dogma, maybe herself. And they were expelled from heaven for the crimes that they committed. There's no way to come back. So if they find a loophole, if they get redeemed and then die and then go to heaven, they are undoing God's word. And that act will unravel the fabric of existence, and the earth and everybody in it and the universe will blink out of existence. So you have to wonder, like, why would anybody want to put these events in motion? Like, what's in it for anybody? What's the problem? Well, we won't find out till the end that Azrael's plan is to do this because he's trying to get out of hell, and no existence is better than an existence in hell, is what he tells us eventually. But it's him. He's the one that sent the triplets to knock out the old man, to kill Bethany, to send Bartleby and Loki to New Jersey for the redeeming arch. So we've got all of our characters in place. We got our bad guy. We've got our unknowing anti-heroes and our hero, the last scion. But watch when they cut back to Bethany and Jay and Bob. Suddenly it's daytime. And I don't think they were, like, she got off work, they saved her, and then they went to the diner. So what is it? Like, how late does the abortion clinic, let's be generous and say it's open till 10. Let's say it's open till 10. So they go to the diner, and they stay 2 hours, and it's midnight. Then they drive, and Jay burns the car out in an hour. It's 1 a.m. Are we to think that they sat there for 5 hours or 6 hours until the sun came up? Like, it's just weird. It just comes off as weird and unsettling, because I know they've got to, you got to do these scenes. You don't want to do them at night if you can help it, because night scenes are harder to light. But it does look badly edited. It's badly edited. It just is. So Bethany's done. She's going to leave. Everybody's done at this point. And we need something. We need something to keep our heroes on track. So, of course, the 13th apostle Rufus falls out of the sky naked to offer Bethany a reason to keep going. It's very strange. Very strange. And Rufus's presence in the movie, while Chris Rock does a great job with it, he has some really funny dialogue. I think the line, "You knew Jesus, knew him, man, the N-word owes me $12, or whatever the line is. It might be the best line of the whole movie. I mean, it's really funny. And Rufus's scene at the movies where they end up, you know, it's our first ending, you know, first thing about movies in the View Askew universe, is it? No. I can't remember. I think movies shows up in Dogma. I don't think it's in any of the other movies. So we've got movies, which is a combination Walt Disney, McDonald's, anti-evil corporation. But the scenes of Rufus at the movies are quite touching because he's talking about Jesus and what a great guy Jesus is, or was, is, still is. But it does beg the question, if Jesus and God, for the purposes of Dogma, are separate entities, where's Jesus in all of this? As far as I know, the Holy Trinity, Jesus, you know, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are one being. Even though it's, I mean, I'm not going to get into a whole religious debate here. That's not what the show's about. But watch Dogma and ask yourself, where's Jesus? Why doesn't Jesus help out? If you've seen the movie, you know why God isn't helping. But even so, humans were put on this earth by God with free will. So Bethany has to want to save the universe. She has to go to do it on her own. So even if God is incapacitated, God's still omnipotent, you know what I mean? Well, I murdered that, didn't I? All-knowing, all-seeing. And is God truly, I mean, yes, for the context of Dogma, God is trapped. And Bethany has to free God in order to wrap our tail up at the end. But Azrael's plan's a little wonky in that nothing happens unless God allows it to happen. So it's an interesting theological question that Dogma raises up. And ultimately, that is the purpose of this film. The purpose of Dogma is to get people talking about religion. Yes, he is doing a piss take on organized religion. No doubt. Every scene is full of acid and anger and madness. But it serves the purpose of, we're talking about it. It's okay to talk about religion. What do you believe? Oh, I believe the same thing. Or I don't believe the same thing. But we can still be friends. And that's the basis of nearly all religions. So, Rufus's scenes are interesting. Again, bad editing. Jay and Silent Bob are nowhere to be seen. We're not shown an establishing shot of the movies having, you know, across the street from a strip club. I don't know. But Jay and Bob end up in a strip club that happens to be somewhere in the vicinity of the movies. It's very badly edited. But I get it. We're stringing scenes together. And the transitions between those scenes eat up screen time. Maybe there is a shot of Jay and Bob crossing the street. Like, hey, Tubby, we're out of here. There's a strip club. And maybe Kevin said, look, the audience is just going to have to accept it. And you do. The first time you watch a movie, half the stuff that goes by on the screen, you're not even aware of. It takes 2 or 3, 4 viewings. Which is why I rarely review new movies on this, because I like to watch movies over and over to get all the nuances. What's going on? What didn't I miss? What didn't I notice? What did I miss? What didn't I miss? Great scene with Selma Hayek as Serendipity. She's the muse. Candy Girl plays while she does some sort of strip war between Jay and Bob and a gang of black guys led by the talented guy from Chasing Amy. Funny, funny dude. But Salma Hayek looks, I mean, as good as she ever has in this movie. And that's an interesting thing. Like, the legend goes that Kevin Smith wrote this script before Clerks. Like, when it came time to make Clerks, he made a movie using the resources that he had on hand. But as a writer, he must have written before, so Dogma is one of those. Now, sometimes that works out really well. You know, when James Cameron decided to make his passion project from his teenage years, The Abyss, it's a great movie. Kevin Smith, you know what? I might have let Dogma stay in the desk drawer. And that really hurts me to say, because a lot of people worked on this movie. You know, a lot of people did their thing on this film. But ultimately, it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. Because it's just so mean, you know? I love me a good black comedy. I love black comedy. High concept black comedy like Death Becomes Her, Harold and Maude, The End, Heathers, you know, brilliant movies. Being There, but Dogma is not in my wheelhouse as far as black comedy. Damon and Affleck are the anchors of the movie. Matt comes off pretty good. Matt Damon comes off pretty good, but the real star of this movie is Ben Affleck. Ben Affleck, it's weird. He's taking the material very seriously. Matt Damon sort of has a twinkle in his eye, and that's Loki's bit, so I get it. But Bartleby, by the end, Affleck is taking that page of dialogue and just grabbing onto it and holding it for all it's got. His scene with God at the end, I know I'm jumping ahead, but his scene facing God at the end, like, he is in that scene. It is incredibly good acting. I know Affleck took a lot of shrapnel for Geely, Forces of Nature, Reindeer Games, Phantoms. But this guy can act. And his scenes at the end of Dogma are fantastic. You're not supposed to like him, but watch it for the performance. That scene's great because I know, we'll get to it. I'm going to, you know, you may have to pause, I don't know, jump ahead and come back because I got to talk about the scene right now. You know, like, this is when I get jazzed. This is when you know movies are good if you can get your hooks into them and talk about them. But the scene, like, I know that's Alanis Morissette who sang Jagged Little Pill in the 90s, you know? Isn't it ironic? And she's wearing is she wearing the poofy silver dress by that time? I don't think so, but close enough. But when he looks at her, I buy that he's an angel, and I buy that he wants nothing more than to go home. Which is part of the plan. To get back into heaven is the plan. But in that moment where Bartleby's looking God in the face, you can see that all he really wanted was to see God again and let God know that he's sorry and that he loves her and he loves being an angel in his faith and he knows the crimes he's committed to get to this point are going to negate any chance of him actually getting forgiveness and redemption. But it's okay because in that moment, and Affleck sells it, he's getting all he's ever going to get until it's over. That's it. One last look at her, and then he's gone. And you know what? It makes the movie pretty darn good at the end there. Even though it's silly with him flying around and the bloody angel wing stumps and all the dead bodies and poor whatever Hicks character Brian's playing, another Hicks. We've had Dante and Gil and whoever this one, I don't remember what his name is, but they're all dead and lying in the street bloodied and it's weird. But let's backtrack a little bit because I got some problems with a couple of scenes in the movie. The scene where Bartleby and Loki decide to exact vengeance on the Moobies executives. Because Moobies is what? Oh my god, subtle, the golden calf. The boardroom scene's interesting because it's the first time we get to see the working relationship of Bartleby and Loki. And how it works is Bartleby finds out who the sinner is. Because we see on the bus scene, Mosier's making out with that chick and they're playing a game. Because Bartleby can read people's sins and Loki, while he cannot, has the power to kill them, to exact God's wrath upon them. So we've seen what the powers are. These are the powers of these angels. And notice they're all wearing hoodies, which are supposed to represent their halos. Rickman too. But in the boardroom scene, it's a little reminiscent of the Liar Liar boardroom scene. You know where Jim Carrey's walking around the boardroom scene and telling everybody what their sins are? That's what Affleck's doing in this. He's doing it non-comedic. It comes off a little, it's awful what he's saying about them. And then Damon just blows them all away. And it's bloody against them. It's blood against the wall. He spares the innocent woman. She's a good person. She didn't say God bless you when he sneezed, but she's a good person. But that sets up what Bartleby can do. So it's interesting when our two groups finally meet up on the train and Bartleby's having a drink with Bethany, that it's played as if he doesn't know who she is. Because when he does figure out who she is, his first instinct is to kill her. It's the first time we've seen Bartleby be violent and that he's capable of that. But my question to you, the audience member, and to Kevin Smith, the director, is shouldn't he have known who she was the minute he looked into her eyes? Isn't that his talent? If it's Loki, we get it, because Loki can't do that. But Bartleby, that's what he does. He reads people. So it's interesting. Interesting. And then there's another fight, and they're thrown off the train, and Bob says, no tickets. That's funny. That was the big laugh line in the theater for me, because, salute, I'm drinking. I get that reference. But when they finally do arrive in New Jersey, all of our teams are moving into place. They're captured by Jason Lee after they've tried to convince Cardinal Glick to postpone. I didn't talk about the poop monster in the strip club. It's another bad scene. It's dumb. The creature looks pretty dumb. I get that that's the money they had. I get it. You are stuck to your limitations. I understand that. But if you're going to have Silent Bob use like deodorant spray, poo be gone, or whatever it is to get rid of him, you got to establish it before. There's not a scene in the movie where he sprays Jay's gas before using it to kill the poop monster. And that's all it needs. One quick shot so that we go, oh, he's got the spray. Brilliant. Yeah, that would have been fun. Clue us in before, not after. It's called foreshadowing. It's called setup. But that's, I'm nitpicking the movie. And I apologize. But isn't that why you tune in? Because I sit and watch movies and tear them apart, either good or bad. But eventually, we find out that Bethany is the Scion. She's the last living relative of Jesus, who Rufus claims to be black, which is fine. Again, anything we can throw at religion is going to get thrown. Abortion, race, you name it. Nothing is left unturned in this film as far as offense, as far as religion goes. But in the end, when Bethany realizes that the old man who was incapacitated is God, because God, for some reason, loves to play skee ball, which is a callback to Chasing Amy, where Alyssa didn't know what skee ball was and had to have it explained to her, which I thought was ridiculous. In this film, God loves skee ball. So he goes to play it once a month, and the one time he went to play it and soak in Earth, the triplets attacked him, put him in a coma, and now he's stuck between the living and the dead. That's where he's been stuck. So Bethany literally pulls the plug on him, and we watch his Holy Spirit explode into the sky, and just before Bartleby, who's murdered Loki, because they both removed their wings to become mortal, although Loki does his willingly, and Bartleby does his letting Jay shoot them off. But before Bartleby can enter and undo God's will, God and Metatron step out. And it's all really well done. The flying angel's a little wonky, but that's what it is. You get what you get. And I'm okay with it. He was just picking people up and throwing them down, so it's pretty messed up. But what we get ultimately at the end is the God literally in the machine, who steps out of the doorway, who comes down from heaven, waves her magic hand, and undoes everything that Bartleby and Loki did. All the people that were killed in Red Bank that day find themselves, what, back home? Waking up in bed? Was it a dream? I don't know, dear. And we get a pretty fun and sweet representation of God. Smelling flowers, enjoying the earth, playful. I enjoyed that. I think it's very well done. And even though, like, I'm not a fan of this movie, I enjoy some of the things that it has to say. As a kid raised religious, I have no problem mocking it. That's the kind of person that I am, you know? No sacred cows, as far as I'm concerned. Anything is worth joking about. The issue I have with Dogma is that it just goes on and on and on, and he's got something awful to say about every aspect of Catholicism, which is weird because he claims to be one and doesn't denounce it and run from it and, you know, shake his fist at his parents for making him go through that. Instead, he makes a movie that mocks every portion of it, except at the end, and then has the mind to turn the audience who's mad and go, what are you mad about? It's a funny movie. No, it's a funny movie at the expense of people's faith. What do you believe? Now, I know the movie's not going to shake anybody's belief in God, but he severely limited his audience by making a movie so anti-religion. It's interesting. I don't think there's simply no way to tone it down and make it palatable. The cursing is off the charts, as per every Kevin Smith movie. And it's just, that's the story he wanted to tell. You know, I applaud Kevin Smith. I wish I'd had the fortitude to become a filmmaker. I didn't have the determination back then to give up everything and throw myself into film. I envy Kevin Smith. I do. I think in a parallel universe, somehow we would have been switched. You know? We're almost the same person, except he's really thrown himself into smoking marijuana this late in life, which I find fascinating. And I wish I could talk to him and say, you know, Kevin, you don't have to be Silent Bob. It's fictional characters. You're a real person. Everybody thinks you're cool already. You don't have to smoke all that pot. I don't know what you're getting out of it, except you're going to put the weight back on eating Twinkies. And we like you. Don't do that. Give us Clerks 3. I don't care about Mallrats 2, but give us Clerks 3. You know, show us Dante and Randall and one final to-do at what it's like to be middle age. It's the chapter, right? But check out Dogma, you know? Let me know your thoughts. Did you really, really like the movie? I don't know if I've met anybody who ever really, really liked Dogma. Because out of the whole Kevin Smith filmography, it stands out as the one where, like, he's thumbing his nose at everything. Now, it's okay to thumb your nose at rude customers and the idea that you can't be the sexual being that you want like Alyssa Jones wanted to be. But faith and religion, man, you got to be careful. Now, I'm not saying careful like, ooh, you might upset the religious people. But careful like temper it. Because in my world, the goal is to make a good movie. I don't care whose religion you're taking pot shots at. Everybody's fair game. But does it add up to a good movie? And the problem I have with Dogma is that it doesn't really. You know, it's a few good scenes. Most notably, the Affleck scene with God. But the rest of it, like, again, Linda Fiorentino looks completely bored the whole movie. She is not game one time in this film. Alan Rickman is undone by that stupid fake nudity scene. Even Serendipity has to lift her skirt up to show what she's, you know, doesn't got. I don't know. It's weird. I'd like to thank Patreon pledger Hendel for supporting the show and suggesting this film to review. I'm sorry it took so darn long. But like I said, I'm trying to get back on track reviewing as many of these classic movies as I can. moving forward, I'll try to, you know, next up is a movie that Michael Bondi selected from the 80s. So I will get to that one as soon as I can. I'm only one guy. I'm only one voice. And I do try. I'm sitting here in the Cafe 80s. It's Tuesday night, 11:30. The crickets are loud, but not as loud as usual. But more episodes as fast as we can make them, because it's weird to find something that you like to do this late in life. It's never too late. You know, I should say that about myself about making movies, right? It's never too late, Jeff, to make a movie. But where would I fit in filmmaking and all that I do? You know, I'm finishing up book 4 of my novel series and continuing this show as often as I can. We hit number 1 today on Podomatic's TV and film listings, which that's just fantastic to me. So thank you to everybody who's listening, everyone who supports the show. Thank you to everybody who came out to my birthday bash a couple of weeks ago. The gifts were amazing, but the friendship and the camaraderie and the fellowship was even better. And that's why I do the show, to touch people, bring them together, and let everybody know, like, that in this weird journey that we're on, this existence, that we're not alone, and that we have voices in the dark that know what we're going through. And that's what this show is. As you can tell, I'm losing my voice. We're almost at an hour of Dogma. So again, thanks to Hendel. If you'd like to support the show, go on Patreon and check out our pledges and our awards and all that. If you don't have any scratch, that's fine too. Head over to iTunes and give us a 5-star review. That would be swell. That somehow helps us in our search listings results. Went to Disneyland today, and Glenn's 91 button on my lapel caught the eye of more than one person. What is 91? Funny you should ask. Let me tell you and give you a card and check out the show. So I love talking about the show. Thank you to everybody who's listening. I am the voice. I am Jeff Tucker. And the show is 91 Reasons. 'Cause I gotta have faith.
Thanks for listening to 91 Reasons. Please subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. Find us on Facebook. Is anyone even still listening?